Okay, let's just one of us right. No, it's working, but I mean, it's not loud enough to really summon the grockles from a great distance that the other one used to be able to do. Anyway, as you see, the difference in stylistically between the work of Ramses, which is by no means bad, and the exquisite work of Seti is pretty dramatic. But just to start off, a bit of an introduction into what we're looking at here, because however beautiful it may be, it's virtually meaningless to us, and even to me, having studied all this time, it still is. And the reason for that is that communication via symbols is, in fact, superior to communication verbally, because the symbols resonate on many, many levels, and the words, not only do they change their meanings, they mean different things to different people, and it's very slow. So, as an example, we have almost no true symbolism left, certainly not sacred symbolism that we employ, as a matter of fact, in our daily lives. But we do have a secular symbolism that illustrates the point and that allows you to see why we don't understand what we're looking at here. And that is the political cartoon. So a good cartoonist, let's say, is doing a very complicated political situation. And he's got Uncle Sam in there for America, and he's got John Bull in there for England, and he's got La Liberté in there for France, and he's got maybe the Russian bear all cut up in pieces like Osiris. In some particular juxtaposed context, in which every single detail is meaningful as long as you know what the context is. So it would be meaningless to, let's say, an Eskimo or a Bushman or an Australian Aborigine who is not indoctrinated into our particular contemporary political symbolism. But anybody else looks at it, and in an instant you get, as long as you're aware of the political situation that it is symbolizing or explaining, however you want to look at it, as long as you know that, you get a total picture of what's being involved way faster than words could do it. If you had to explain any old political cartoon to a Martian, you'd have to start at the beginning, explain why the Russian bear is a Russian bear, what's Uncle Sam means, what John Bull means, what the situation is. And by the time you were done explaining all of this sufficiently well so that somebody could understand it, historically, philosophically, I mean, there's no esoteric content to it whatsoever, but just at its external level, you'd probably have spent a month, and by that time you'd have forgotten what the whole situation would have changed, so it was no longer valid. So what we look at here, at these silent figures, we can see that it's all harmonious and it's very beautifully done, and the Seti work is absolutely exquisite. So we react or resonate to the aesthetics of it, but we have virtually no the what's being dramatized, or what would be a drama, an ongoing drama to an Egyptian priest, is meaningless to us, and almost has to be, even if I can decode some of this stuff and say, well, you know, who the figures are and why there is X number of this, and why the symbols of one of them are this way and some of them are some other way. It's all just articulated, and it doesn't really register. It doesn't really register emotionally, but just knowing why it doesn't register emotionally already is a step forward, because otherwise it doesn't mean anything at all. So anyway, we're looking at it here, and we haven't talked about this almost not at all. I mean, we're the only temple we've been to, Zabidas. So we're looking at it here. So here we have the king, Ramses, and he's wearing his royal apron, the meaning of which is pretty opaque, other than that it is in some way or another sexual, with the rearing cobras suggesting pretty much the kundalini energy. But if you look at the royal apes, you see they're all different from each other, and that here we have what you call five cobras, and another one there'll be eight, and another one there'll be two or three. None of this is chance. None of this is the artist saying, oh well, it feels like this, so I'll do three cobras here, and let Joe do the other eight, or whatever. We just don't know why it is like that, but it is. I mean, in other words, it's significant. It's having here what that's his Jehuti.
Yes.
This is Jehuti, or in the Greek thought, which is a very strange derivation of the Egyptian Jehuti. It's been suggested to me by a friend who knew some Greek that maybe the original to the Greeks who put forward T-H-O-T-H, theta, whatever it is to spell it in Greek, but it might have been pronounced Tahota, which is pretty close to Jehuti, in fact, so maybe. Anyway, the two, and the animals that are associated with the gods, they're always animals or birds or insects or plants associated with the principle, with the divine principle that is that particular god. If you know enough about that animal or bird or plant or whatever, it gives you a clue to the inner meaning of he or she who is being figured. So to the Egyptians, of course, this would have a meaning. That's an ibis bird, almost extinct now in Egypt, but they find it down in Africa, and it winters in Turkey for some reason or another.
And
it's a bird that is particularly, evidently, a particularly intelligent bird. And Jehuti represents the principle of cosmic wisdom. We'll go through Jehuti a lot as we go along. And they are blessing the king with
watchers.
With holy water, as it were, in the shape here of Ankh, interspersed with this strange scepter, which looks kind of like my stick here, which is called the Ras scepter. And the Ankh represents the life force. And it's thought, the academics are probably correct in this, that there are various explanations of why the Ankh is the Ankh, which transmutes eventually, in fact visibly, we'll see it in Dendera, transmutes into the cross of Christianity. But in the Ankh, the loop is a stylized womb, and the bar and shaft, male genitalia, so what else is life but the fusion of fusion of male and female. And for sure, here, sometimes there are just streams of Ankh. Sometimes there are Ankh interspersed with the Was scepter. The Was scepter is something that's pretty mysterious. Sometimes you see it very clearly here. It's not that visible, but it's an antelope's head, or gazelle's head, rather. And it is an emblem of Set, and because Set is in charge of, or the lord of all that is wild and undomesticated, and as I said, the flower describes him as as he who fixes spirit and matter. So the Was scepter to the Egyptian, sorry, to the Egyptologist, is usually called, it signifies dominion. Yes and no, dominion over the wild world, as it were, that which does not have access to the light. But then it gets more complicated once you get a little deeper into it, because you see that it has this strange loop at the bottom like this, which is, I mean, if you, we'll see along the line, we'll see Ankh, we'll see what sectors that have been grown, in other words, they're organic, others that have been made. But what the purpose of that loop is, nobody, to the best of my knowledge, nobody knows. So this is just an instance. I mean, you could do an explanation like this, or an attempt at an explanation, non-explanation, of why these things mean to practically everything that we look at, because we really do not know in depth why practically everything is the way that it is. Some things we do know, more or less. Down below here, all of these figures are Hopi, the Nile, old man, and old woman, river, and they are making offerings. Each of them represents one of the gnomes or states of Egypt, and they're making offerings of the particular provenance that comes from that particular gnome. If anybody wanted to go to the trouble, I'm sure there's good PhD thesis in figuring out why, because none of this is accidental. There are X number of this and X number of that, and so forth and so on, the iris flowers upside down, all the rest. Somebody could figure out why there are that number of offerings. In other words, there's a science of offerings. There's a science of gesture. There's a science of position. We'll be looking at some of that as we go through here. So let's go on to So here you see, I mean, the difference in art is dramatic. And the John theory is that, and it also it has a progression in that in the early stages it starts out as a very simple and geometrical, and then it progresses, getting more and more complex until eventually it becomes degenerate. You see it actually, a good parallel is in Renaissance art that starts around 1200 or so with Giotto, very stark and simple. And then by the high Renaissance of Michelangelo and Donatello, you know, and Da Vinci and all of those guys, it's become very, very complicated and fabulously beautiful. And then as it goes along into the Baroque and the Rococo, it gets just to be art for art's sake, terrifically elaborate, very, very skillfully realized, but de-spiritualized to a certain extent. But in Seti, everything is working together, all together. But with Ramses, which is much cruder, for whatever reason, he was on this campaign over a long lifetime to produce as much
building
and art as he possibly could. I mean, it's hard to imagine the length and breadth of Egypt, of the kind of artistic activity that was going on under Ramses. And the John guess is that one of the reasons that it's cruder is that there simply wasn't the time to train enough virtuoso sculptors and painters to the level that his father, Seti, was in command of, maybe. But anyway, it's definitely not of the same order. But here, you do a bit, but you can't do this with every one of them. But here's Osiris sitting on his throne. The throne, by the way, is the symbol for
Isis.
On her head, is the symbol for Isis. But here you see the throne is covered in fish scales. Why fish scales? Maybe having to do with the myth that I was telling on the bus of the kind of fish that swallowed the phallus, the phallus of Osiris. Maybe. Anyway, because it's a pretty odd, when you stop to think of it, why the devil would they cover a throne in fish scales? You can bet there's some reason. Not that the artist came along and said, I think fish scales would be cool. And here again, you have the symbol of the union of Upper and Lower Egypt. So there you see he's clutching the Wasit scepter, which, as I just noticed now, penetrates right through the throne and right to the ground. Might be a hint of something there that somebody could decode. On the, he's clutching the emblem, other emblems of power. He's got the
Hekar.
Shepherd, he's got Hekar, which is the shepherd's crook. Anybody know what a shepherd's crook does?
Grabs the animal, right?
That's right, yeah. It's what, when I lived in Wales, that you could grab the, how you bring the sheep into the fold. The symbolism, actually, you'll see as we go along, a lot of it is absolutely familiar, even if you're not a practicing Christian or that familiar with Christian doctrine. The symbols come right to meet it, mostly. And the other is the flail, which is both an instrument that winnows the wheat from the chaff, again, biblical, and that in another context becomes the scourge, the cat of nine tails.
What does it use for?
For whipping. For whipping people who deserve it. So it would be a big business in Wales. And I'm sure, I don't know it, but I'm sure that there's a reason why there are that many beads in the flail and that many, you know, that many whips and so forth and so on. Everything has that context. And here, okay,
John,
here we have
Osiris. Osiris is wrapped, is involved.
Oh, yes, he's always shown in mummy wrappings.
Yeah?
That's right.
And but, it's sealed like in a big cross, X.
Yes, he's in mummy wrappings. On the rounded back here, that's his palette, his scribe's palette.
Where?
I believe in the back.
No, it's the rest of the jewelry. The jewelry hangs here because he has a piece of jewelry.
The counterpoise, right? The jewelry.
But he's receiving. He's receiving from
the king.
The incense burner is burning incense to Osiris, and he's pouring the good water into three altars shaped in the heart shape. That's Ib. The heart. The heart is very important in this as a center of the understanding of ancient Egypt. All right? And if you see, just a little look at the city and every one here, even the plane. Look at the toe and the detail. Huh? Look at the knee and the dress and the navel and the nipple. The elbow and the mouth, and it's very, very well perfectly executed.
Anyway, Osiris and his mummy wrappings, what he's clutching here are the one aspect of the emblems of power. In other words, he cannot act, but he nevertheless has power in his hands,
right.
Literally.
So he has the brains.
In this particular context. And behind him is Horus.
The elder, and the great one.
And holding an ankh and also wearing a fish scale costume. And on his head is the fusion of here. Osiris seems to have a kind of bowling pin, looks like a bowling pin on his head. That's the white crown of the south. Horus has a fusion of the red crown of the north, which looks like a tin can with an antenna on it. And the bowling pin, until very recently, it's a very strange thing with these headdresses and crowns. No one has ever found, apart from the actual diadem that you sometimes see, a circle with a suture that mirrors the suture in the brain, and the rearing cobra at the third eye that the pharaoh wears. Nobody has ever found a physical representation of any of these crowns.
Isn't there a hawk
and you'd
in
think,
the back?
What?
Isn't there a bird in the back of the diadem as well?
That's not the diadem. No, I don't think so. That's not the diadem. That's, unless I'm misunderstanding it, that's the statue, the Khafra statue with the falcon integrated into the back of his head. The diadem, we'll see it, but it's the famous one of Tutankhamun. It's gold, and it circles the head this way, and it has a band this way, right at the suture of the brain, and then it comes out in a rearing cobra head, and sometimes in a fusion of cobra head and vulture head. We'll get into that. You see, I mean, just this little bit that we're talking about here, we've covered this much, and a lot of talk has already gone by. You could do that with everything in here. Anyway, in this one, back to the animal or bird or whatever, chosen to represent that particular principle is the falcon becomes the Christ and represents the return to the source, the ability to return to the source. Why the falcon? Because it's a bird that flies high up in the eye of the sun, effectively invisible. When it sees its quarry, it's the technical word is stoops, it folds its wings and it dives at a speed that the ornithologists marvel at, because it's much more, and it's wing folded, it's much more than gravity should allow. I mean, unbelievably fast, 200 miles an hour or something. It grabs whatever it's after, a pigeon or a rabbit or whatever, and flies up again invisible into the eyes of the into the eye of the sun. So perfect living symbol of exactly what Horus actually represents. And so it goes with all of the different symbols. If you have a good idea, and this is the same the world over, the same applies in India, you don't have elephants in Egypt, so they didn't use elephants, but basically all of the old cultures used animals for particular reasons. The Native Americans used bears and, you know, and wolves and whatever for very specific things, and what they were talking about. And anyway, and I was going to say with those mysterious bowling pins, there's a book out recently by an artist I know that really, I don't think he's right all of the time, but he's done a book. His name is Jonathan Meader, M-E-A-D-E-R. Anybody's taking notes or ask me about it later. Very fine artist. And he's written a book called, I think it's 50 New Discoveries About Egypt. Anyway, he's got to the bottom of a lot of these mysterious symbols and shows how they are derived from other common features in Egypt. And a lot of people have been trying to do that, I think, not successfully. And I think Meader has actually done it successfully. There's a hardcover version of the book that's pretty expensive, and a lesser one, which is good enough for anyone, including myself even, that's pretty reasonable. So anybody who's bitten by the Egypt bug would do well to Google up, and you'll find examples there. Google up Jonathan Meader and this new book of his, because he adds something really significant to the ongoing development of the meaning. Over here, precisely nothing. And here you see he's clutching the various emblems. He's got the flail again, and he's got the crook again, but now in a very different position, an instrument called sa, which means health. For the Egyptologists, it may, sure it has some deeper meaning than that. Here again, the throne is full of fish scales. Over here on this side, the goddess Mat, with her ostrich feather, right? Is that
yes,
Mat?
Yes.
And behind her is Renpet, right?
Yes, the year.
It's the year, it's the goddess of the year. Each of them wearing a different costume. Why, I don't know. Sometimes you see, what are they here? They've got two right hands, and sometimes, in this case, both of them have two right hands. Sometimes they have two left hands. Sometimes they have a right hand and a left hand juxtaposed. Sometimes it's the way it should be. The usual explanation of that is that the artist made a mistake. And you see, art taking place at this level. It's pretty comic to come up with an explanation
behind
like that.
Him is,
and behind him is Isis. That's the first time we've seen
her throne. So when you see a lady with this emblem or crown, it's Isis. Okay?
Oh, Isis, yeah.
And even her name is written right in front of her. The same seat with a half circle and an egg. Isis.
Isis.
Isis
is actually
and
the
then
name.
This is Mr. West.
This is
Mrs. West.
This is the goddess Amenthit,
of the West.
Which is the goddess of the West. But very peculiar headdress in which
little thing that she's wearing, like this, and the half circle, semicircle, is the hieroglyph for two thirds, for the number, for the fraction two thirds, and the Horus on the top of it. Very mysterious. I know what each of the little, each of the pieces represents, but have no idea why that should represent the West.
And the last one is racist.
But the set is, you don't need much esotericism to understand set. He who well, not just he who fixes spirit and matter, but he who prevents the return to the light. I mean, set is very active. And so, to get a good handle on it, when I turn my computer on in the morning and it defies me to put words on it, that's set. It really is. And every one of us, the alarm bell rings at 4 in the morning and jump twice, another 4 o'clock alarm call. That's set at work. And the ability to acknowledge and appreciate set is a real life lesson. Just percolates through Shakespeare, sweet are the uses of adversity. Yeah, as long as you can use it. If you go down under it, and it's very hard not to in our present degenerate age, we're its victim. But even that knowledge that we don't have to succumb is an important life lesson. I mean, it's one that I don't forget too often.
Hey, John.
Yeah.
You say that there's many, pairs of gods and goddesses that are point and counterpoint, like Osiris and Set.
Yeah.
So is that the relationship between these two on the right and the two on the left? Because they have two right hands each and they have two left hands each.
Ah, very well noted. Very good. I don't know.
But this one has right and left, yes? Isis?
Isis does, but
that's a good question.
In attendance on either side.
Why the pair there and the three behind? I have absolutely no idea. Little mini thesis for the bright young PhD student who hasn't shown up yet. You can see, even from this little bit of disjointed talk, how much is involved in this, and how, if we were initiated Egyptian priests, you could sort of get an inkling of what this would tell them as they walked in. It would be something enormous. Every bit of it would have its own resonance and into a massive understanding. So here we're looking at the throne again, and look underneath here. You have the life and the dominion. What's it? Something is dispersed with health. And another context, you have just one or the other. Well, I don't think you ever see just what's it, scepters, but sometimes I see just on.
Did you see how the wall plain but shining? See the quality?
Yeah.
This stone and beside the cutting and the see the shine, huh? Anyway. This one. This is one of the most beautiful jet pillars in Egypt, in size and realization.
The jet pillar is another symbol that you see all the time. Very often, it's one of those, certain of the symbols become, were used time immemorial as amulets, and the Ankh is one. And the Waset Scepter in conjunction with it is another, and the third one sometimes in conjunction also is the Jed pillar, and here we'll see a better one inside. It's said to represent, it symbolizes the backbone of Osiris. It's that which allows us to stand erect in the physical world. But on the top part here, very elaborated, it's got these five bars across. It's thought by some people, maybe correctly, that it represents the I think there are five
vertebrae?
Not five vertebrae, but five sets of vertebrae, that the sacrum and the lumbar, and I don't know the names of it. If I have a doctor or a nurse with on the trips, they know which represents what.
So it may be that, and then you've got, you know, all the complicated stuff there, the rearing serpent with a disc on its head, probably representing the kundalini energy. See the bars on the top? Anyway, would reward a big and concentrated study. Oh, here's the red crown of the red crown of the south. The red crown of the north.
Lower Egypt,
with looking like a tin can with an antenna on it. What this it means, one. Jonathan Meader does a good job of
look at the cobra coiling at the third eye spot of the crown of Seti. Look at his ear, of course. He's presenting might to the triad, Osiris, Isis, and Horus. Isis here, she has the crown of Hathor, but you see her name is written right next to her. This is the triad, and it's like what? Hiya, John, presenting equilibrium. You said that Seti wants to present might again after Akhenaten.
Want to reestablish the hegemony of Ma'at over all of Egypt, and symbolized by this temple.
And the cobras in here, in his apron, is eight this time.
Yeah, the cobras in the apron. So all of this, and also actually, strangely, you see that he's wearing a costume with a bull's tail.
In the back.
In the back.
That's kundalini?
That's almost certainly kundalini
energy.
The kundalini energy of the, because the bull represents around the world, the sexual sexual power. So.
And of course, this is the first set of the set of seven sanctuaries. Each one is dedicated to, you know, there were three triads, and in the center, no, in the back, Seti has his own sanctuary as the reconciliating.
Yeah, reconciling all of the. All of the principles. And this one is.
I am in love with the crown.
This one's got to be Horus, right? So this is Horus.
This
right?
is, I think or this is. Isis. Oh, no, that's Horus then.
That's Horus.
Yeah, the first one is Horus. But here, guys, please, look at this shining wall with the color now. Huh? If you are wearing white, it reflects back on you.
So
and then the detail can go forever on it.
So, and all of this, as I mentioned earlier, everyone's probably forgotten. As I mentioned earlier, whenever you see color, this looks as though it's very faded, but it isn't. If you put the right, if you use the right solvent on it, it would come back, it would clean it out, and it would come back absolutely as though it was done yesterday. We'll see a few instances of that. Early in the 1900s, they wanted to do this, and they had some sort of solvent that they were working on, and they applied it in Dendera, and it all became fabulous, new, fresh again. And within a week, it was worse than it had been before, because it was the wrong solvent. They didn't realize that. And then subsequently, the Italians are the geniuses at restoration, and for good reason, because they have all of that Renaissance work to work on. And they had, at one point, they were doing the tomb of Nefertari, who's the queen, the great queen of Ramses the Great, and it's a terrific tomb. I mean, everything was practically intact, but very faded. And so now they were restoring it. And I was with a group of journalists, so I got in there while they were working. It was incredible to watch them, because now they knew that they had to use a different solvent for the reds, and a different solvent for the yellows, and a different solvent for the greens. And they had students in there with hair, with paintbrushes, you know, like three hairs doing eyebrows and stuff like that. And they ended up with this fantastic thing. You walked in like into a jewelry gallery. And it was open to the public for a while, expensively, and first come, first serve basis. And of course, it sold out quickly, and so there became a business, and scalped Hatshepsut tickets. Nefertari tickets. You'd send somebody to wait online through the night to get tickets for you. So they closed it to everyone. I must say, I participated in that too. I was about to sit wait online all night long. I was happy if I could pay an Egyptian guy £100 or something to do it for me. So then they closed it down, but now they've reopened it again on some other basis, and I forget what.
how equitable it is, but it's very expensive. I mean, really a lot of money, and we don't do that. So, not on this trip. Anyway.
Okay, anyway, this is also setting, but here you see the kilt is pleated and white, then it gets more, not so finely pleated, it's straight. So you see the leg, look, red flesh, but here it's pink. You know what I mean? You see behind, see through.
Right.
It's transparent. Look at the fancy belt. And what's this scepter?
What? That's the mace.
The mace.
The mace of the war mace.
Uh-huh. And Isis, and here she's feeding him with the ankh.
She's holding it to her nostril.
Like pumping life to him through his nostril with the arm. So this shrine is the shrine of the sanctuary of Isis. Look at this, all in white, no color.
Now, I want to point something out to you, which you may or may not have noticed on your own. I mean, some of it has color, some of it doesn't. But we've seen some of this before, but not quite as markedly as it is here. And here you see it's not just, it's the Ankh, and here you see the fusion of Ankh, Waset scepter,
and Jet
column, all together in one, offering life, dominion, and
stability strong
to the nostrils. But here you see, you notice here that the hands have been effaced. And look carefully, you see that it's not an accident. I mean, this has just been damaged somehow.
Yeah,
that's just been damaged. That's been done by somebody. I didn't point it out at Luxor Temple last night because it would have taken up still more time, and it's not as significant. Here, suddenly, it becomes significant. We'll see. I'll talk about it. I'm just pointing it out to you now, but we'll see more of it as we go through.
Look at the pink leg
again
for the linen, then
for the translucent.
No, back to
the flesh looks pink.
Yeah. This is Anubis. And this is the sanctuary
is the guide through the underworld
of Osiris.
Associated with embalming. According to Schwaller, see, this is the royal apron, sort of extending out. It doesn't look at them. In other words, if you're wearing a kilt and you're walking with it, it's going to be billowing out in front of you. So this is sort of symbolizing that. But according to Schwaller, he's done careful studies of this particular shape. When it occurs, the royal apron, as it's called, and has determined, and this may be a point when I'm not sure that he's right, usually I'm pretty sure when he's right, that determines the geometry of the particular frieze that it's a part of. I don't know if that's actually true. And at the very end here, for some strange reason, is a fox head. And there's always a fox head there. And the word for first, we'll see it, Are fox skins tied together. Why exactly the fox in that context, I have no idea. But it's one of those, you know, not a peculiarity, delivered for some reason. Why?
We are going down to the sanctuary of Osiris. And here is a great vulture with a shimmering look.
Oh, yeah.
So beautiful. It's compared to the one in Hatshepsut.
Yeah, not exactly that, but the color.
Yeah, and
there's the Shenling, the Shenling of eternity, which, when you stretch it out, becomes the cartouche.
Right, it becomes this.
And the vulture is one of the, I'm not sure if that's Nechbet or
Mu. Oh, Nechbet, sorry.
One of the symbols of the cosmic, the female cosmic sky goddess. Mm-hmm. Over here.
That kilt holds the same shape when they kneel.
Yeah, that's pleated, so it stands this way. But look at this jet that brings from Waset to jet to Ankh.
So, to us this is opaque. You notice it, and you know that each element in it represents. But what does it mean? What does it represent in context of this particular tableau? We don't know.
And here's Osiris is in green.
And now he's in green, and he's seated on a throne which has alternating stripes. And everything has a meaning, and we don't know.
You notice that Seti is opening the door in the little tabernacle, the shrine where the statue in full size of the deity or the principle is placed into it. So he's opening the door and then he's kneeling in front of him. There are like rituals done almost daily.
Yeah, they are done daily. And actually, what you see is the rituals. This is what's going on in here every day. Mm-hmm. They're opening the door and then they're going through all of these various ceremonies and rituals.
Look with offerings.
This is what he's actually doing, what a high priest would be doing it in his stead, because this is not open to the public. Here is another instance of the deliberate effacing. And the face is effaced, and the fingertips have been effaced. And what this is, actually, this is a John discovery. The face of Osiris is effaced, the hands have been effaced, things are left intact. Elsewhere, we'll see when we go inside, things have been left completely uneffaced. Right here, there's a face, this is a face, this. And Isis on the end here.
She has double cobras in Hathor crown.
That's Isis. Beautiful. Yeah, that's Isis with the Hathor headdress, left completely uneffaced.
Yes.
And the king and Osiris has a little bit of face. And I'm sure what this is that there are different kinds of effacement. Some of it is revenge. You can tell when it is somebody getting even with whoever's tomb it is. In other instances, it's never, but it's always, it becomes, you see, when we get to the time next, absolutely deliberate. And what I'm convinced that it is, and this would be a really important study, is that this is done by the priests of Egypt themselves when it's clear that Egypt is falling, that it's disappearing, that the doctrine is disappearing. And they are, for reasons of their own, which we don't know, but some of it should be decipherable, they're putting to rest. Effectively what they're doing, they're decommissioning these aspects of the temple represented by the various figures in their particular contexts, and they're leaving uneffaced that which pertains to the new cycle that is coming up. And ballparking it, I'm absolutely convinced that that's the case, but it would be a wonderful PhD subject for somebody. And I know enough, if I could put together a talk, which wouldn't have to be too long, systematically, to do a presentation to the enemy, because I could do that. You don't need credentials for certain of the Egyptological conferences. And I have a good title for it, which would be The Self-Effacing Egyptians.
I would like you also to notice the curved sky, Nut, huh? And then the stars. Remember John told you, kings, when they died, they become stars with the cartouche of Seti. So the cartouche of Seti and the stars adorning the sky, Nut. And in here, you'd see one of the most beautiful and elaborate scenes of Isis with the wings, because she turned in one point to a flying bird to collect her husband's pieces everywhere, from everywhere. She's really protecting or embracing Osiris, where Seti is giving him two magnificent golden necklaces. His kilt is also in gold. There's a lot of gold in this temple. A lot of gold.
Okay, let's... that I'm doing it. It would take a long time to get through this entire temple. But here, look at here now, you really see the wholesale but selective effacing. I mean, it's obvious that this is actually one of the things I would say is probably the only crime that the Christian church is charged with that it's innocent of.
Why are they always pointing ankhs on either side? Like the whatever god figures are always pointing the base of an ankh at whoever's
approaching.
Sometimes
it's a loop and sometimes it's the point. And it's there. You might say they're plugging in light. It's sort of like putting in a something into a socket. They're aiming it at, well, in this case, aiming it at the navel of Seti, but yes, it's there. It's They're charging them, as it were. They're charging. Yeah.
It's like when you go to a spiritual leader and they.
Yeah,
like that.
That's right.
What, I forget what that's called.
Clonking.
What is it?
Clonking.
Clonking?
Clonk on the head.
Yeah, no, there's a word for it. Darshan. Darshan.
Darshan.
In Indian.
John, yeah. This hall is called the Hall of Horus for the 10 pillars? The
yeah, well, they call it the Hall of 10 pillars, but as soon as it's you see 10 pillars, you know you're looking at Horus symbolism.
And
these, actually, these. If everybody got into these, I don't know, but these are, you know, brilliantly
yes.
realized, and they're almost, I think they're almost entirely complete and uneffaced, are they?
Yes, mostly
completely.
Left alone, and they are dedicated to Osiris, Isis, and Horus. You check them
right.
out, please.
Ah, and you know what? I was thinking it too. Because this is the entrance that's left open.
Yeah.
And it's leading through the Osiris temple. It's leading through the Osiris temple, but the myth of Osiris culminates in the birth and ultimately the rulership of Horus himself.
Yeah.
So the principles were what? So that this is left more or less intact because those are the principles that still pertain to whatever the civilization
going on.
The ongoing civilization. Yeah.
But also Amun-Ra enters
and
left.
And with Amun, both are the two ruling principles
yeah.
at the time. And over here, some more, and I'll stop boring you with this.
You check the
shortly.
Rules?
Well, again, but you can check it all you want, but the thing is that unless you explain to a certain extent, you don't understand. But here are some really, couple
yeah.
of really interesting instances of it. And in the other wall, a few very significant symbols. Here, this is called, you mentioned earlier, that the Pharaoh, once he took over, had a number of names. He had five names, actually. One was his birth name, one was a different name as the ruler of Upper and Lower Egypt.
Golden Horus.
There was one as the Horus name,
Egypt,
and then
Zara, and the bull.
And then the Golden Horus.
And the bull, yeah.
And, yeah, anyhow, so this is a palace facade dating from very ancient times. This would have been mud brick.
Yeah,
pre-dynastic, with Horus on top there. And as you see, it's left entirely intact. The king offering Maat.
Oh, yes,
Maat is left intact. He's completely obliterated. Here is the king, and here's the Nekhbet vulture with the ring of eternity.
And the cartouches are good.
And the cartouches are left intact. He's left. Out. And this is again. Ra, who is this again?
Atum.
Who is this again? Atum.
Maybe it's an Atum. Yeah.
Is it Tay on top?
Menu. When Menu.
Where's what's his name? The inspector here, is it Hizam?
Hazm.
He was here.
He does every time, and we forget.
Yeah, Hazm, I think. Anyway, left completely.
Actually, it's Ra. John, look, here is Ra, and then the mouth here under the jet. The snake and then Ra. Here, look. Here, Ra.
Oh yeah, no, that's not. That's eternity.
No, that's Jed, but on top of that, right?
This is the symbol for eternity. The twisted. I mean, it's a DNA actually, basically. It's a double helix with
the sun. Look at the horizon with the sun growing up.
Anyway, that's entirely intact. And so around the temple.
John,
over here, what?
This is a great Horus and the whole design under with teeth, Osiris and Isis.
Right.
The belt and the jet crown.
And again, left intact. That's just, you know, incidental damage.
But there is a cow head on top.
Oh, yeah. A pato, probably. Yeah.
Well.
So, you know, you can imagine that you can devote your life to decoding one room in this temple. And it would be a really valuable thing to do. That is what they are doing, which is by and large looking into the details of Tutankhamun's laundry list. You can't imagine an actual Egyptological conference. I mean, these are the most uncreative, dullest people on earth. And it was very funny when I was first getting shock interested in the whole idea. And he was
you know, semi-convinced. He hadn't been there yet, but he said, oh, there was something to it. And I said, well, you have to really see what's involved, because I'm always, you know, coming down pretty hard on the academics. And Chuck, so I brought him to an RC conference that they had to have in New York City. And I was watching him, and Chuck was sort of shaking his head. And he came out, and he said, wow, he said, you weren't even exaggerating, because it's mind-boggling, the level of pettiness that is involved in most of their research. But it's slowly, slowly changing. Now every time there's a conference, there are four or five things that look as though they could really be of some consequence to the ongoing. But, you know, it's a long way from becoming symbolist Egypt, but there are signs.
I have to tell you that the Osirian, the great Osirian, is right there. You see, and here the scene is to erecting a pillar of Osiris. See what I mean? So the Osirian is right here.
Right behind.
Right behind. Yeah. Right? And what happens here is Isis and Seti are putting back the pillar. This is this is Osiris. It's interesting, kind of like power going power. Message. And then here the Mechbet gives the Shen ring to the king, but here it's the falcon who does that. Like, it's very interesting. You don't really see much of Horus doing this. I don't know if this is Horus or soccer, but a falcon gives it. You know, usually it's Mechbet. Huh? The vulture. Yeah. Mechbet is the goddess of the south, protection, where Cobra was the north. But look at those two cones. We see these in Kumambo. John? Are these the cones of Kumambo? They are the Medusa, what do you call it? The pharmaceutical symbol. They look like the ones in Kumambo.
Oh, maybe.
Yes. Pharmacy people know that.
That is part of all this. No, that's the caduceus. That you see that in Egypt, probably. Not with two snakes, but with one coiling up.
There is also in Kumambo.
Like a barber shop.
Did you see the second? Second stick with the hair, with the eyes?
With the eyes. Second, second means power. It's a mace or a scepter, meaning power. And Sekhmet, which is feminine power, and that's her name, means feminine power.
But they are setting up again the pillar of Osiris, and here it is standing up, you see?
Yeah, here you can see much better jet pillar, but it's not stopping.
Beautiful jet.
Those four looks sort of like the beginnings of a rook in the chest, but not really. And representing maybe the backbone. But on top, the twin plumes, cold plumes, they're not plumes, I don't know what they are. The headdress of
Amon
with the solar disk in front of it.
And here it's more, look at this.
Oh, that's a more complicated one.
Right.
Yeah, so again, you know, something for a scholar to do, to decode, because they had the leisure to do so.
The treasure of the temple is under this
room. Well, okay. Okay, yeah. Let's continue, yeah.
Yes, let's go.
I wonder what the little
onyx is. You notice how irregular are those wonderful blocks. So very regular and so fancy. Beautiful limestone.
As I told you, it's not the little onyx, but these are back and the new baffles. They're holding the
the little people with on heads holding up pillars.
There's not the only place that they are either.
John?
What?
That's your favorite story.
What?
Favorite story.
Oh,
cleaning mate. She's so beautiful doing this. Look at her hand. There's one around me. Who can get away from a Jewish mother?
kind of nursing, actually, breastfeeding the young Horus, who is really sort of an adolescent, so which either has some inner profound meaning, or it's a signal that the ancient Egyptians weaned their children very late.
Well, he's growing on Isis' divine male.
That's true.
Yeah, and look at how she holds him. Really, it's a grip here. It's a beautiful, beautiful scene. And look at her foot, John. Oh, well, we're going to see this in Philae, but you see, her headdress is a vulture. It's part of her brain. Look at the vulture totally on her brain. Huh?
Oh, wow.
And there are two cobras and a vulture head, upper and lower Egypt, and a cobra. This is a beautiful crown. Very detailed, very colored. Beautiful. Here it's the fusion of Ankh and Wasit being given. This is a connection between the boy and his mom. Huh? And how mom protects and cares for baby. What? It's not Amun, it's Rahrabti. And is this jewelry called Minat?
That's the Minat necklace, thought to be by Rishi Lami, who is Shwala's stepdaughter, another symbolic womb, and
really?
associated with music. Rishi goes into that.
Jiggles.
Yeah,
thanks for that. Oh my God, I love that.
Yeah, and anyway, that's a particularly good sekhmet. The lioness, we will spend some time with her while we're in Karnak, if we successfully bakshish our way into the little chapel.
They're holding hands.
They don't clasp, but their thumbs touch. Their thumbs connect.
Yeah, none of this is an accident, and also none of it is an accident when they've decommissioned the act by
the fingers. Skin, which is one of these ceremonial costumes of the high priest or high priestess, probably representing what it does represent in Mesoamerica,
what?
Where the rites of manhood, as it were, is killing a jaguar, which symbolically represents a sort of taming the wild animal within. We'll see instances of that as we go around.
And she's but writing, see? She's writing. She is
the female counterpart of Jehuti, in other words, feminine wisdom, goddess wisdom. And she's got the strange headdress that people argue about. And even Jonathan Meader, I think, he thinks it's a marijuana leaf, but I don't. It's one of those, like, instances where it's a vacation with them. But still, it's the seven-point star under the
above?
Sky? Under what seemed to be the horns of the moon.
Oh, really?
The crescent moon. Well, maybe. I don't know.
Well,
it does look like a crescent moon.
But there is a lot to say here.
This is the palm frond, actually, which represents the year and the symbol up here.
Hebsed.
It's called the Hebsed Festival, which is a
a renewal festival that the king physically performs after 30 years in office.
And then the tadpole
at the end,
with the shin ring.
The tadpole, the shin ring, so this is the tadpole represents, is the symbol for 10,000, I think. 10,000 or 100,000?
100,000. Look how many hundreds of thousands of years.
Yeah, lots and lots of years of transformational years or of transformed years.
Yes, she's right.
And the funny thing is, again, why should a tadpole be used as the symbol for 10,000? I forget if it's 10,000 or 100,000. But if you look at a pool full of tadpoles and count them, you will find almost always that there are 100,000 tadpoles there. Anyway, a shitload of tadpoles in the pond. So hence the use of that symbol for that particular number. It kind of registers. Anyway, in here there are...
Also here, John, it's one of the rarest places that you see the Inye, the group of gods, the Inye of Amun-Ra, Mut, Khonsu. That's the triad of Luxor. Ra, Shu, Tefnut. They are the first form of energies and principles creating cosmic. And here is Weser, Osiris, Jehuti, and Isis. Why Jehuti, not Horus? Huh? And then here they are again. No, that's another set of deities. That's Geb and Pet. That's Geb and the sky and Wipwa with Tefnut, Shu, Ra. You see, it's a head. Here is Horus, John. In the middle. Yeah, and there is the bird. The falcon, and this is Iset and Wasit. So they're Indians. And these are here are the gnomes, what do you call them?
They're the slaves.
The slaves of Egypt. And the stands.
Up there on that register, they have very
King is yellow.
Group of the jackal and.
Two of them,
Anubis and Wetlawet.
They represent the different gnomes of Egypt, but look in the end, John, the Jet and the Wasit and the Hun, they are carrying them, they're holding them with hands.
Anyway, this would have had a lot of study. It's a very unique.
What's this one up here?
Which one?
The three birds. The three figures with the bird head.
No. Here?
Yeah.
Straight away that it's when the king was young.
adolescence.
That's a young age symbol.
Okay.
All right. What's the thing on the
cobra, and then a feather of mine.
This way, you
mine.
Go.
Yes.
What time is it, by the way?
11:35.
Okay.
Tomorrow we're going to visit the best chamber of Anubis. You will.
Where?
Anubis.
Oh, yeah. Everybody, let me come around. Where are they? Now, you've noticed all over the place, probably, these round holes everywhere. On one of the trips, actually when I was filming with my criminal partner Boris, who had a sense of humor, and somebody said, "Well, how did those happen?" It was instant. He said, "Oh, those are the ancient Egyptian rock peckers that used to get all the food out of the rock, but they went extinct because by the time they got to the food, they'd worn away their beaks." So this is the work of the ancient Egyptian rock peckers. Actually, what it is that once the temples fell into disuse, the locals used them for tent. They put tent poles in there and stretch them across and make little homes or domiciles or huts or whatever inside the temples and outside the temples. Those of us around here. Over here. Spectacularly executed reliefs of the resurrection of Osiris when he's furnished with his golden phallus for the one night. And you see here he's on his funeral bier, and they do have reliefs. We don't get to see them if we run out of time at Denderah, where the whole tableau, the whole history of history of Osiris is, of the Osiris cycle, is portrayed in 27 successive reliefs. And here I forget exactly where this is in the cycle, but here Osiris is furnished with his golden phallus by, this is the hawk-headed Sokar, who kind of represents what Sokar actually represents is the imminent spirit of the return to the source at the very earliest stage of creation. In other words, creation is created with the possibility of return to the source, and it's that possibility that is symbolized for Sokar, who has the hawk head of Osiris. And here he's got his golden phallus, and he seems to be saying, this is Isis over here with her throne, he seems to be saying, "Oy vey, do I have to go through this again?" Whether or not he's really saying that, I don't know.
Then, the other side. Like,
on the other side, you have him.
This time it is Horus.
Who is there, actually, because Horus is the cosmic principle, so he's there already at his own conception. As when he comes to Osiris, and here you see Isis in the form of falcon, settling on the, impregnating herself on the upright phallus.
And you get her name, Set.
And there's her
Iset.
Iset.
And she's there.
And it's funny because when you read Plutarch or any of the others, they always say that Isis takes the form of a kite, which is another kind of, not a flying kite or this thing, but another kind of a raptor. But that's not it. She's a falcon. And I had on my trip one time a well-known falconer. And I said, is that a falcon or is that a kite? He said, that's a falcon. So, and why shouldn't it be? Because Horus's symbol is a falcon. There's no mistaking that. So it stands to reason that his mom would be a falcon as well. So those, some of those things get passed on without question. What? Talmud, you're talking about?
Of course. Hmm?
Yes. Oh, well, here's the upright hippopotamus, but this is not such a good one.
But so sweet, you don't see.
The upright hippopotamus is Tauret, who is the goddess of, or the principle of gestation, of pregnancy. And the reason for that is two reasons, a number of reasons. One is that what could be more pregnant than a pregnant hippopotamus? And the second thing is that the hippopotamus is the only land mammal that gives birth underwater, in one of the dramatic representations of what happens. And funnily enough, Walt Disney, most of you seen Fantasia?
Yeah.
Now, remember the Giants of the Hours? Now where the devil, I forget who composed that. But the Dance of the Hours in the Disney version, Disney had an inkling into these things. I mean, Pinocchio is a Gnostic fable. It was some Disney, he's an awful man in many ways, and some of the stuff that the studio does is absolute garbage. But some of it is illuminated, it's brilliant. And with the Dance of the Hours, he has, you know, the crocodiles of death. And the hippopotamus, the hippos are doing this eternal dance. And I forget who the composer is, somebody pretty famous. But he's onto it. And, you know, so it resonates to this day. Even if you ask Disney why he picked those characters to do it, you might not have known exactly. Or maybe he did, I don't know. But it's an interesting instance of the symbolism transcending the exigencies of the particular age in which they're mirrored, are sometimes unwittingly going back to very, very ancient roots. In this case, I don't know, but it is a peculiar thing. It's a very memorable piece of that very remarkable movie, Fantasia, which I learned only recently from my enormous surprise, was not a financial success. That's fantastic.
Really?
Yeah. Not for years and years and years.
No, you can dissect so much in that.
A little bit differently. This is the famous Abydos king list in which Seti is sort of, I guess, giving a lesson, a history lesson, to his son Ramses, of the kings of Egypt preceding himself. And in fact, when Manetho is a Greco-Egyptian keeper of the library early on, I think 2nd century or 3rd century BC, and he was charged with putting together the history of Egypt, and of course he had a lot of scrolls at his disposal that he could do, but still no complete Manetho has come down to us, but fragments have, and the scholars who were very familiar with the Greek text even before they could translate the hieroglyphs were wondering how accurate Manetho was. And then they stumbled across this king's list, and when they could translate the hieroglyphs well enough, they realized what they had. And so they have, in fact, the list that Manetho had at his disposal of the pharaohs of Egypt, and it really is complete. There may be a couple of minor ones that have been omitted, deliberately omitted toward the end of it. It's Hatshepsut, who was transgressed probably by taking on the role of pharaoh for herself, which she wasn't supposed to do as a woman, and Tutankhamun, who wasn't really accepted as legit by Seti, who followed Tutankhamun, and Akhenaten, of course, who regarded as a great criminal. But anyway, you can read the hieroglyphs in order, starting from here, and that's within the cartoon, and that's Mina, Men, A, or A, or E. That's Mina, who discovered the hotel. Actually, that was his role. There were no hotels before Mina, and he invented the hotel. Anyway, there's a lot, there's an elaborate, but we don't have time to go through it here, of questions that have been answered, historical questions that have been answered by this kingdom. Let's go through here and into the Oseirion. This is, I believe, this is all Vincent Ramses, right?
Of course, from New Ramses.
But it's very high level artwork in the Ramses era. And here you see what they're doing here is they're lassoing and taming the wild bull. This is symbolically the taming of the sexual instinct, bull being, and probably the origins of both bullfighting and the bull throwing ceremonies that they used to perform in, is it Crete? Knossos? It was Crete, wasn't it? Did they do that? And even to this day, you have the bull throwers in Washington, D.C. and other places where they're really quite expert at this. So this scene here, so this is integral to the esoteric traditions, is some form of control over sexual instinct. On the other side here, a very interesting representation, which I'll do briefly here, usually in Sakara, this is called fouling in the marshes, this is a clap net. And normally, because the iconography here is, you know, they have to portray it in a certain way to make it sense, but this is a net, big net, that's hinged. Let's say the size of the floor here, that's hinged in the center, and decoys are put on the net when it's down, and the birds come in and go after the decoy, and then guys who were hidden in the swamp, in the papyrus reeds, somebody takes a scarf or a piece of cloth and goes like this, and everybody in the front pulls the clap net up, and the clap net goes whoop like this, and you catch birds in it. And so, but sometimes, so this is accepted generally by the academics, as well, that's how they actually catch birds. Well, they do. They do actually catch birds. Papyrus swamps have disappeared now, but until very recently, they were catching birds. And the birds represent wild spirits. And so once they're captured or domesticated, they are under human control. So it's an element of the eternal Osiris or Horus set struggle. But I recognize as a John discovery that it didn't figure that this was just birds, because in certain of the representations, they have not just birds that are being caught, but antelopes and sometimes captured enemies and all kinds of wildlife. So, I mean, that's a hell of a day hunting when you're going out, not only getting the birds that you went after, but you've got captured enemies, and you've got antelopes and all kinds of desert animals. And then here, this was kind of the clincher, because here you have the clap net being shut by a retinue of the gods. So this is not everybody can go out hunting with a retinue of the gods and come up with a net full of birds. And anyway, I've developed that since then, and it's a very interesting minor aspect of the ongoing development of the symbol of the touch. Over here, this is a total mystery, and I've been talking with my friend Charlie Herzer about trying to decode it. He might be able to. This is called the Boat of Sokar. And you see, where is his head? The Vulcan head is up there. The boat is being towed by
the king.
By the king himself here. And you see the boat? I'm not sure if those represent oars, and there are all of these birds going up here. There's an antelope head looking the other way. and there's a lot of fish. What the hell this means, I have absolutely no idea, but it's a recurring motif, so it's got to have some pretty significant significance. I don't know what it is, and I've not had the time to research to see if anybody had actually figured out what it is. But the problem with lack of research assistance is that it's supposed to research everything, and you know, if you had somebody pressing the buttons, you might actually come up with an answer pretty quickly.
Soccer, by the way, is connected to the cemetery, to the west, to the land of completion. Saqqara is named after soccer. All right? So it has something funeral or, you know, the other side, not this side. All right? We'll go through this, which is Seti again, to the outside for the Osirion. So let's go. And here there is a beautiful couple, Tahan and Sekhmet, Amun Ra and his wife Mut. Beautiful tomb in here. There is not one place that doesn't have something great. This part of the temple again is Seti. That was Ramses, this is Seti, leading to the Osirion.
This is older.
Seti is the father.
The father, okay.
1300 BC. And Ramses is 1290 BC. I think. Yeah. Because after Sutan comes. Before it was Akhenaten. Then Sutan comes. And then. Then Sisu was a great one again. But I think that his heart is somehow touched with the Akhenaten. You remember yesterday when you were talking about action?
This is the Osirion, and big debate over the age of it, because the sandstone walls around are Seti the First, or clearly Seti. On the other side, we see that arch over there that leads to a long passage. Now, this is a lot of the work of my pal Charlie, with funerary texts. And in the inside there, if you go in, and you can't get now anyway, one, you can't, not allowed to, and two, it's full of water. There are more texts, that's the work of Charlie again, decoding, but then Here there are no texts, and you have these gigantic columns, all of which come from Aswan, in this strange configuration that looks like nothing done in the New Kingdom or Middle Kingdom, sort of reminiscent, it was thought, when they first discovered these, or rediscovered these in the early 1900s, to be, you know, very similar in style, not in size, to the Valley Temple of Khafre, and it resonates with that, but on a much grander scale, and it is practically unthinkable for the dynastic Egyptians to construct a temple, you know, deep in underground. And there are, you can't see it here, but there are shafts, deep shafts, and I don't think anybody's ever really explored them. You have to go down in the diving suit, and it's all murky water. The water rises with the flood level, you know, with the water table. And I'm not sure whether that's original part of the intention. We think, Jacques and myself, that this is all much, 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 much older, and it probably is an Osiris temple, but from one of the much, much earlier periods. This is more work if we ever get our panel of geologists together to really be able to come and do the detailed work that has to be done, and that can't be done without A, the finances, and B, the permission to go and do the work. And actually, it used to be they'd let you down into it, but we couldn't do that now anyway because the water comes up. They put in pumps. I think the Swiss put in massive pumps to be able to keep the water out. And of course, once the fuses blew or something like that, they never got around to fixing it and putting new fuses in. Something of the sort.
Square notches that are seen on these granite blocks and other ones around.
Sandstone ones there? Some people think, but
the
it's
ones on the top.
What, the ones on the top?
Yeah, they're sort of padlock.
Some people think that the protuberances, and they've been sort of hammered out here, but that the protuberances were left there in order to get a purchase on the blocks when you were lifting them. But sometimes that doesn't seem to apply, so I don't really know, but that's the standard explanation that's given. Getting these things into place in the first place is another matter, and there are no protuberances at all. It's absolutely perfect, you know, absolutely perfect precision of these gigantic blocks, which are probably upwards of 75 to 100 tons, brought down, of course, from Aswan. But this is actually, one of the most powerful places in all of Egypt. And it's not a bad idea, even if it's just for a minute or two, to stop listening to me and me stop talking and do an instant 2-minute meditation.
hardly ideal, but...
Thank you.
So, let us...
No, wait.
What?
Well, we have to mention that there is a flower of life here.
Oh, don't.
Yeah? And also, there are paintings that look like way before even the earliest pre-dynastic time. It's under this architrave here, in this section.
It does look as though it's like pre-dynastic representations. The flower of life is popularized by Glenn Below Melchizedek, who did too many acid trips.
Yeah.
Back in the
creation.
Who's this?
It's a Euclidean geometry.
Okay. Right there. You see, go down. Look, Ben. Oh. Look here. It's the edge inside. See? The circle. Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. Who's bag is this? Someone's bag. Yeah.
Now on 50s helicopter and a World War II Abrams tank.
And then it's a submarine.
And but the thing is,
there's one and there is a tank.
A very good one is expert in the hieroglyph, named Edmund Melser. Has decoded all of this, and it's pretty well known in Egyptological circles that the original carvings here, when they were done by Seti, were plastered over by Ramses, who then put his own inscriptions on top of into the plaster, which interfered with whatever the carvings were below. And when that fell away, you did get what does in fact look sort of like a helicopter. However, you really don't have to be terribly astute to figure out that you can't channel up a helicopter or a tank out of thin air. You need a very developed metallurgy and a whole complex of, you know, decades, if not centuries, of technological sophistication, lots of metal and all of these sorts of things. So a helicopter, a single helicopter, presupposes a very, you should have lots of machines flying around and, all over
charged.
The place, littered, charged, pot charged, kettle charged. So anyhow, you really don't need the definitive explanation to dismiss the premise, but they, the unicorns will not have it that way. And so we battle on, but we don't really care too much about what the unicorns have to say. It's the quackademics that we have a problem with, because since they own the playing field still, but they're running. They're moving. Let's go.
There is a picture. One picture.
What's that?
Maybe the
she had an NDE really when. When she was a kid, she fell down the stairs and they pronounced her dead.
In London,
she's English, and they went to get the coroner or whoever pronounces on these things. By the time they got back, she was sitting up in bed perfectly okay, but after that time, she was never quite the same. And at one point, her parents took her to the British Museum, to the Egyptian exhibit there, and she went absolutely bananas. She wouldn't leave. She was holding on to the statues. These are my people, blah, blah, blah. And she went on about this way. It's one of the more compelling instances of reincarnation. Because reincarnation, there are lots of stories, but there's not that much that could really be used as evidence. Anyway, the book was turned into, I think it's called In Search for Om Seti, by a
guy I know called Jonathan Cott. That was published in the 80s, and it's a pretty good book. He doesn't get deep enough into symbolist Egypt, though he knows it. He was afraid to himself. And
she lived here.
She lived here all of her life, her little job.
Yeah. She
and
has a son.
She's an interesting lady. I knew her toward the end of her life. And she lived very poor, doing little trinkets and stuff, but she was making significant discoveries all along for the Egyptologists, who didn't know what to make of her because they couldn't just laugh her out of, you know, into non-existence, because she kept on saying, look here, and they'd find something. Anyway, it's pretty
And she kept
book.
The treasure of the temple.
She said,
where it is, but she wouldn't
she
say
said,
where.
She said, there's a lot of interesting stuff about Om Seti. And then, so there's the book by Jonathan, and I don't know if they think they have another book by a woman named Catherine Dees called The World of Om Seti, where she has access to the journals that Om Seti left with her, thinking that she had, that her whole story was, you know, that she was a temple priestess who had an affair with the king, and she wasn't supposed to, and she got pregnant and committed suicide rather than disgrace the king. I'm of two minds about that. I think the king could do with whatever he damn pleased back in those days.
Yeah.
Anyway, the Catherine Dees book, I don't think they have, but the Jonathan Cott book they do have here.
We'll check
and
them.
You'll see, they'll try and sell it to you. But
that's what
they're doing. I reviewed it actually for the New York Times. I had a friend of mine who was book editor at that time, and he passed on to me reviews when they were Egypt related, or sometimes even if they weren't. I hated working for the Times. A bunch of pricks there. Paid very little and were always busy editing me. I figured if they could write as well as I do, they'd be writers, not editors. And when my friend left for his job, I no longer wrote the reviews for them. Some of them are kind of fun.
I was in her grave last